Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed thy hands hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000 besides. Faithfulness, Lord, every morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. So faithful to me.
Let us pray. Father, we bless you. We thank you. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. We exalt you. We magnify you. We declare your glory and your faithfulness over our lives. For all this, we say thank you. Thank you, Abba Father, for saving our souls. Thank you for causing us to still be joined to the living, not to the dead. Father, we cannot thank you half enough. Please accept our thanks in the name of Jesus Christ. Tonight, as we go into your word, Father, please open our eyes of understanding. Speak to us. Give us revelation according to your word by the help and power of the Holy Spirit. Father, we pray that this evening, for each one of us tuned in, for our families, indeed there shall be peace, there shall be joy, there shall be healing, there shall be deliverance, there shall be salvation, there shall be a new beginning in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let somebody shout, hallelujah, hallelujah. You're welcome to today's Digging Deep. My prayer for each one of us is that as we dig into the scriptures with the help of the Holy Spirit, everything that God has for you, for me, for us, will be received in the name of the Lord Jesus. We want us to start this evening by just thanking God. The Bible tells us that for he that is joined to all the living, there is hope. A living dog is better than a dead lion. Doesn't matter what surrounds us, We are alive. God has kept us alive, and it's for one purpose: to honor Him, to give Him praise. So why don't you thank God this evening? Thank Him for salvation of souls by His hand and His mercy done during the past lockout period. Let's thank Him for your life. Thank Him for provision. Thank Him for breath of life. Don't take this for granted. Thank Him because you can hear. You are not in a hospital. You are not being fed by a tube. You are not on oxygen. Thank Him. He's been our shield and our protection. He has not failed us. We have His word forever settled in heaven. Thank Him for the word He's going to speak to each one of us tonight. Thank Him because you shall receive it. It shall avail for you, for me, for us, for our families, indeed for the whole nation and the entire world in the name of Jesus. Just thank Him. Thank Him. We can't thank Him enough. Bless Him. Lift Him high. Glorify Him. Magnify Him. Honor Him. Take time out to focus on Him, even during this brief period of digging deep, and just exalt the one that's worthy to be exalted, to be glorified, to be magnified, the one worthy of your attention and my attention. Give Him all the worship. We bless you, Lord. We lift you high. We magnify you. We declare, let your glory fill the world. Let your glory fill our hearts. Let your glory fill our families, O Lord, so that you alone will be our focus. Thank you, Lord. Please accept our praises. Accept our thanksgiving. Accept our worship. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. The text for our digging deep this evening is taken from the book of Mark, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, verse 37 to verse 41. Mark 4, 37 to 41. And the message is titled, Be Still. I pray for you, for me, for us, that there'll be stillness against every loud evil noise in our lives, in our homes, in the nations, from this night, in the name of Jesus Christ. Where there's still pandemonium in our lives, in our thoughts, in our emotions, in our finances, in our health, in our loved ones, I pray that God will still all tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. Mark chapter 4, verse 37 to verse 41. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him, and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind, and he said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased. And there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that ye have no faith? And they feared exceedingly, and said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? Everything in your life, in our lives, in Nigeria, in the nations, that have refused to bow to everything known and done by human beings, I pray in the name of Jesus that they will bow today. They'll obey the word of God in the name of Jesus Christ. The scripture we have just read is God's word to one person, to me, to us right now. Be still. Be still. Be still. Tell yourself, be still. Put your hand on your chest and say, be still. In your body, be still. In my emotions, be still. In every raging wind, be still. To things seen and unseen, hidden storms that want to rear their heads at these times, we say, be still. In the name of Jesus Christ. This were the words of the Master Jesus. And the Bible tells us in John chapter
6:63, the Gospel of John 6, verse 63,
that the words of Jesus that he speaks are spirit and life. So I want us to speak it loud and clear now. Again, put your hand on your chest. One, raise one up and say, in the name of Jesus, peace. Be still, be still, be still. Fear, be still. Coronavirus, COVID-19, be still in the name of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Hebrews 13:8. If he spoke and the winds obey him, everything that had defied obedience will obey him, as we declare and as I've declared in the name of Jesus. Every boisterous wind, in Jesus' name. This evening, I want to see what to do, some of the things we should do in the midst of any storm. Before we look at what should be done in any storm, in any boisterous wind, let's look at some examples of what could be a storm. Number one, the storm. Something that causes fear. Something that gets the attention of somebody in the negative way. This was a case where the disciples were crossing to the other side as commanded by Jesus, and suddenly there was a great wind accompanied by a storm, and everything was shaky. That's an example. Number two is another example in the case of Jonah. In Jonah chapter 1, we look at verse 4 and verse 5. Jonah had been commanded by God to go to Nineveh, to go and preach and warn the people of Nineveh. But instead of obeying the Lord, the Bible tells us, let's look at verse 4, that he didn't like Nineveh. He didn't want them to be converted. He didn't want to tell them the truth. He wanted to be destroyed. So instead of going to Nineveh, Jonah went in the direction that God did not ask him to go. And what happened in verse 4? The Lord sent out a great wind into the sea, and there was a mighty tempest in the sea, so that the ship was like to be broken. Then the mariners were afraid, and cried every man unto his God, and cast forth the wares that were in the ship into the sea, to lighten it of them. But Jonah was gone down into the sides of the ship, and he lay and was fast asleep. When you have a storm, many things come in. Fear, unwise counsel, counsel that's not of God, unwise decisions that can take one even deeper into the negative, unwise advice. There's confusion, there's uncertainty. Regrettably, loss could also occur. Depression. There could be suicidal tendencies. There could be financial hardship. There could be shame that seems to linger and reproach. There could be poverty. Things that will unsettle the person, the family. We don't need to look too far to know that the pandemic is an example of a storm. It's all over the world. Different ideas are being tried. When the scientists think that there's a solution, they find out that there's a bot connected to it. There are different things on the media that causes confusion, so that one doesn't want to listen to news anymore. In such a time, what should we do? Let's look briefly at six things that I believe will help us. Number one, at a time of such different voices speaking, howling, let's remember that God also speaks. We should never forget that in the midst of so much noise, there's a still, silent voice that wants to engage our attention, the voice of God. God is the same yesterday and today and forever, Hebrews 13:8. And when God speaks to his children, it's always be still, peace. Why? Because God had been aware of the pre-beginning of every storm. And he alone knows the way to stop that particular storm. He had been aware of it long before any human being got to know about it. Long, even from the beginning of creation, he had known that in such a time in creation, this event would happen. And he speaks whenever there's a storm. God doesn't speak in the ways some people have been speaking. He doesn't speak with fear. He doesn't speak with condemnation. He convicts. And since he has not changed, I believe in this era, God is still speaking, peace, be still. In Luke chapter 8, verse 49 to verse 54, Luke 8:49-54. The daughter of Jairus was ill and eventually she died. The announcement Jesus got before he got there was, don't trouble the master anymore. Jairus' daughter was dead. Those were the voice and the voices all over the place. Don't bother, it's a hopeless case. When Jesus got there, he spoke. His words were different. He said, fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole. When he got to the house, he first of all put out those who were speaking what they saw with their eyes. They put God out of the equation. And he brought in only Peter, James, and John, and the father and the mother of the little girl. Again, Jesus spoke as everybody outside was weeping, bewailing, crying, some genuinely, some not genuine. Again, Jesus spoke. Today, God will speak into your life, into our lives, into our situations. And Jesus said, weep not, she's not dead. She is not dead. They laughed. Jesus ignored their laughter. At times like this, we need to ignore a lot of things. And then what did he do? He took the girl by the hand and he spoke again. Made arise. Jesus spoke. The Lord is still speaking. We need to continuously speak the word of God. As we continue to speak that word into our lives, we're strengthened, we're empowered. Jesus spoke, then the Spirit of God came back into that girl. And that was the reversal of the words that had been broadcasted. Every word that's not of God, that is being broadcasted concerning you, concerning us, God will silence and superimpose with his own words, filled with power, filled with the Holy Ghost, the anointing to reverse every negative pronouncement in the name of Jesus Christ. In the book of Acts, chapter 27, verse 23 to 25, Acts 27, 23 to 25, Paul was on the way to Rome, was being taken to Rome to be judged. And the Bible tells us that there was a great storm, a tempest. There was great fear. Great fear. Raging storm. What is Paul say? He said, don't be afraid. Verse 23. For there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve. Do you belong to Jesus? Listen to the word. He said, that angel said, fear not, Paul. You must be brought before Caesar. You must reach your destination. You must fulfill your destiny. In verse 25, he says, wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God, and it shall be even as it was told me. God had to send an angel specially to speak the mind of God. The mind of God is that you shall fulfill your destiny. We shall fulfill our destinies. There shall be no loss. Fear not, and it shall be so, as God spoke before through that angel in the name of Jesus Christ. In Luke chapter 7, verse 13 to 14, Luke 7, 13 to 14, the story of the widow of Luke of Nain, the widow of Nain, her only child, the son, died, was about to be buried, and then suddenly there was divine intervention. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ concerning COVID-19, every other infection, known and unknown, every sickness, physical sickness, emotional, marital, there shall be divine intervention in the name of Jesus Christ all over the world. Even as God has always been intervening, because He created the world, He's the one who knows where He needs to intervene. We pray and we call upon Him this night. Father, let there be divine intervention. And as Jesus came on the scene, He touched the coffin. Everybody stood still. Be still, brother, sister, be still. And He said, young man, I say unto you, arise. We pray in the name of Jesus. Please join your faith with mine. I join my faith with yours. That God will touch everybody sick in hospital. Everyone precious to us. With spiritual sickness, physical sickness, the frontliners in the medical field, those who are in depression, because of what is blowing all over, God will intervene. He'll touch them. He'll bring strength to the families, and He'll say, weep not. Father, do it. And I pray that God will send each one that word that will turn things around in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray for you as you are listening, for us. Do not be in despair. Receive that word of God. Speak the word of God. Every time you receive the word of God, even this one you are receiving, speak it daily, many times in a day, and it shall avail. Because the word of God is forever settled in heaven. Praise the Lord. Number two, when there's such a storm and confusion and fear and everything that accompanies this, God always demonstrates that He's the one in charge. Many times we don't even see the hand of God because we're too busy and occupied by things we're pursuing. And our rights and our goals and our opinions. But when there is a storm and there's a confusion, please let's remember that God always wants to and always demonstrates that He is the one in charge. And He's still the one in charge right now. When Peter was sinking in Matthew chapter 4, 30-31, because of the boisterous wind. Matthew 40:30-31. He had done all he could do. He obeyed the voice of the master. The master said, come and meet me. And he obeyed. He stepped out of the boat. He stepped into the water. And then a great storm came in. Peter started to sink. Jesus just stepped in. Suddenly, Peter cried out, Lord, save me. Verse 31, immediately Jesus stretched forth His hand, caught him and said, why are you afraid? This is a small thing to me. In the name of Jesus, he will send, stretch forth that same right hand of deliverance to you and to me, and take us out of the deep pit that we may have been put, that we're not even aware of, because of COVID-19 and the raging storm all over the world. God will demonstrate that he's in charge. He'll take us out. He'll take this nation out. He'll take those in leadership out of confusion so that they'll not make decisions that are not of God. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Another example where God demonstrates, amongst many others in the Bible, but for a shorter time, we'll just give another example, is in the same Acts 27, when Paul was on the way to Rome. The Bible records that all hope was lost. The tempest was great. It brought darkness for days, for weeks. But you know what? If you look at verse 44, Acts 27, 44, there was the ship, part of it had been broken in pieces, but they still escaped to land. There was divine intervention. Number three, at such a time, refrain from speaking wrong words. Refrain from taking decisions you had been taking before, some of which have landed us in fear personally. Let us look in areas of our lives where there must be a change so that God will bring a change. Let's refrain from doing the wrong things, actions, things I feel like doing but may not be what God wants me to do. This is a time that we've gone through lockdown. It means we can't do it. Things we never imagined we could do. God demonstrated that with him, nothing shall be impossible. That the flesh can die. Let us at this time, more than before, not only during this pandemic, but even after, because affliction will not rise again. Let us subdue the flesh. Let us kill the flesh. So that the Spirit of God in us will have dominion. We'll rule our hearts, our thoughts, our decisions, even though they may appear difficult and strange to us, things we will not normally tolerate or want to do, but because we know that if we don't humble ourselves, God will humble us. As it is clear now, Daddy has told us that when God sees what he wants done, he's not talking to the world as a vacuum. He's talking to us, everybody that's alive in this universe, in the world. There must be something in me that God is still waiting to see to be done. A change. And I believe it's for each one of us. That blind spot that we don't care about, God wants it to be brought to my attention and your attention. Don't speak wrong words to other people as well, no matter how provoked you are. The children, your spouse, whoever you meet. Don't decide, I'm cutting this one off. I have nothing to do with you again. No. In the scripture we read, the disciples said to Jesus, said, don't you care if we perish in that storm? They already made up their minds they're going to perish. They already believed that they will not make it. And they spoke it. And it's out of the abundance of the heart that the mouth speak. Our language must speak, must change. Our vocabulary must change to reflect the vocabulary of God. In 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 10 and verse 12 to 15. 1 Kings 17, 10, 12 to 15, the story of the widow of Zarephath. When the man of God Elijah was sent there, he got to the gate. He saw the widow. She was gathering the sticks. And Elijah called her and said, "Please give me some water in the vessel. And then cook some cake for me, some bread." And the widow said, "I have nothing, only a handful of meal in a barrel, little oil in a cruse." And she said, she was gathering two sticks so that she could put it together, make something small, so that she and her son could eat and die. She had even killed herself with her words, with her thoughts. She never knew that this thing would pass. She never imagined how the turnaround could be. All the things surrounding her pointed to the end had come. Death had come. Until God says it, it is not so. So what are we saying? Suddenly, God came in through the man of God. 14. "For thus says the Lord of God, the barrel of meal shall not waste." It won't finish. "The cruse of oil will not stop." And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah. And because of that, the negative words that she pronounced were reversed. This is a time we must change. We must decide ourselves. If you are not giving your tithe before, start giving your tithe. Some of us were not giving an offering because of the excuse that we've been locked out. But that's not an excuse, because God is aware. In every way, there's always a way out in every situation. Change your mind, brother, sister. Let our focus be, what does God want me to do at this time? How does he want me to do it? What would he have me speak? Would he have me reply? Would he have me take this decision or not? In the past, some of us have taken decisions that were not the decisions of God. They seemed okay, but they may not have been God's decision. There's a way that seemeth right, but the end thereof is of destruction. In Acts 27, 29 to 31, the same Acts 27, but 29, 31, the midst of that storm and uncertainty and sudden change in the atmosphere, people were in the sea. Some of them were going to take the wrong decision. They were going to jump into the water. They thought that was a way of escape. But Paul said to the centurion, to the soldiers, those who were guarding him, to take him to Rome. He said, "Stay in the ship, stay in the boat. Don't let anybody jump out." But because in the ship, there's security. Because God was there. In that place, before you take the decision to exit it, ask, "Am I exiting the presence of God? Am I exiting the presence of God?" He said, "Except this abide in the ship, ye cannot be saved." Brethren, don't be discouraged from giving to those who don't have now. Abide in what God wants you to do, in God's way of life. Because it's very clear that my calculation, your calculations, have defied all the plans we made before. Stay in God's boat, in the secret place of the Most High, under the shadow of the Almighty. Abide and be stable. Psalm 91 verse 1. Don't go out and come in. Because each time one steps out of that secret place of God, one automatically steps out into the secret place of flesh, of self, or of Satan, or of the world. And we see the world cannot handle what is happening now. Stay there. I pray for each one of us that all the evil thoughts, the wrong decisions that have been deposited in our systems, in our minds, are coming with sicknesses, every disorder, negative words, God will destroy them now with the blood. And let's pray that prayer right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, concerning every wrong thing I have done, every I have contributed in an indirect way into allowing fear and storms to come into my life, Father, please have mercy on me. Things I have done to which I have been blind, even when I was corrected, that did not seem significant, that I overruled. Pride, when I prided myself as okay, when I qualified myself, when everything was about me, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus, please have mercy on me. Let the blood of Jesus Christ that speaks of mercy cleanse me and bring mercy to me and everyone that's been affected indirectly or directly by my pride. In the name of Jesus Christ. Now let's have a quick look at God. If we know God and we know Him even more and more the way we should, we'll be still. So let's quickly just look at one scripture in the Bible that describes God that cannot even be described. The Lord who says, I am the I am that I am. The one who says, I can be to anybody, anyone, anything at any time. I decide how to do, when to do, in the way to do. Nobody can question me. Psalm 115. Nobody can query me. I'm sovereign. When I decide to show mercy, I show mercy. When I decide to withhold mercy, I withhold mercy. I created every human being. I created every wise man, wise woman. If I remove the breath, nobody can restore the breath. When I decide that the breath cannot be removed, nobody can remove the breath. I made you and the whole world and made me only for one purpose, for my glory, says the Lord. Just for the glory of the Lord.
Psalm 104, the Psalms 104 says, Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, thou art very great. Thou art clothed with honor and majesty. Who covereth himself with lights as with a garment? Who stretcheth out the beam, the heavens, like a curtain? The one who lays the beams of his chambers. God's upstairs is in the waters. The one who makes the clouds his chariot, who walks upon the wings of the winds, no matter how boisterous any wind is the footstool of God. He walks upon the wings of the wind. He makes his angels spirits, his ministers a flame fire. Verse 5. The one who laid the foundations of the earth, that it should not be removed forever. Only God can remove the earth because the foundation was laid by Him. For as long as the foundation is intact, nothing can be done to the structure. And God laid the foundations of the earth, and He says it will not be removed forever. The one who covers it with the deep as the garment, the water stood above the mountains. At thy rebuke, they fled. Hallelujah. At the voice of your thunder, they hasted away. All these things we're seeing. Just at God's rebuke. Just at the small voice of God's thunder, they flee away in a hurry. Verse 9. You have set a bound that they may not pass over. No matter what the winds are like, no matter where they're coming from, no matter how boisterous, God has set a bound. Thus, you have come, you shall go no further. And I think we should go home and read it, because for time we cannot go through. But when you read it, it makes me humble, and it should make you and I very humble indeed.
this God. And that brings us to the final word, which is in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17 and verse 18. 2 Corinthians 4, 17 and 18. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal. Therefore, just a time, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Which tells me it will pass what we're going through. So be still. And evidence that I'm still is that my flesh daily, not when there's pandemic, when there's not when I have a dream and I'm challenged and I'm afraid, not when there's a problem, but every day my flesh must die so that Christ in me will be the hope of glory, so that every decision I make, every thought I think, every little step I take will be under the cover of the Most High, as dictated by Him, not by what I feel like doing. And too, because I'm striving, it's because automatically Christ is now living in me the way He should. I have the mind of Christ. So gradually, the mind of woman of self is reduced, is diminished, and the mind of Christ in me is elevated. Therefore, the things we're seeing, they're not forever. They will pass. The COVID-19 will pass. I like 2 Corinthians 4, 16 in the New Living Translation. It says, that is why we never give up. Verse 16. Don't give up. Though our bodies are dying, my flesh, your flesh is dying, because what I want to do, the Spirit tells me I must not do it. But as my flesh is dying, my me-I is dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. Every day. So one goes down, so the other will come up. For our present bodies are small, our present troubles, what we're seeing, to God they're small, and they won't last very long. Daddy has said so. Daddy, you are Father and the Lord. He has said so. It's not forever. God is looking at me, at you, who are Christians. And those things that don't glorify Him in us, He's seeing whether after the pandemic, they'll still be there, because He knows. He knows whether I'm intent and resolute on dealing with them. And that version says, yet they produce for us a glory and vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Don't look at how difficult it is right now. If I can stay indoors, I can please God too. And can hate my flesh. Not everything that is good is expedient. Not everything I decide to do may be of God. No matter how confident I am in myself, flesh can fail. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. Brethren, I want us to make this our resolution. Galatians 2:20 says, I am crucified with Christ, dead with Christ. Good Friday last week was the day we remembered, or we celebrated, the death of Jesus on the cross. That verse says, I'm crucified with Christ. Christ who went to the cross just in obedience to the Father Almighty, the Father who glorified Him.
Christ, who humbled himself and then became exalted and lacked nothing after, seated with God the Father. We can't be seated with God the Father and have lack any good thing. Challenges will come, oh sure, because we're in this world. But in the secret place of the Most High, as my flesh is crucified with Christ, then I'm not the one living. I'm not the one in charge, but Christ who is living in me. So the sign of my Christianity, of my being with Christ, is not because I say I'm a born-again child of God. It's not because I'm reading His Church of God, I'm in another church, another parish, but because Christ is living in me on a daily basis. I'm not here there, not here there, but I'm conscious of the fact I'm not here there. So my goal is different. What I want to achieve is changed to please Christ and Christ alone, to please the Father alone. It will cost my pride, my opinion, cost money when necessary, cost changing my decisions I've taken in the past. But you know, the more of Christ I live, the more of Christ that lives in me, the more every plague becomes a stranger to me and to you. Yet, not I that lives, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. My old self has been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And I do not treat the grace of God as meaningless. My brothers and my sisters, more than before, let us make a decision that from today, my focus, my goal, is to live a sanctified life, set apart from the systems that are not of God, the thoughts, the ways of life that are not of God, and to be set unto God and God alone in that secret place of the Most High. It means I choose to be holy, to be separate, to be different, to be dedicated, to cut self away from this, from that. I'm not saying avoiding that one is a witch, but cut myself off from what God says I should cut myself off. It's in the Word of God. So that I shall be cut unto, I shall be engrafted unto Jesus in all my ways, in my heart, in my words, in deeds, and every other way. Then I want more of the one that lives in me. That's when I'll pant for him more and more. So when I sing, I want more of you, it's not because I've not every song, but because I realize that I need more and more of Christ in me to take over, so that I can be still, so that I can be still, so that I can be still. So that when I get to my home, I get to my office, the Christ in me will bring automatic peace. When I take decisions, I'll not fret. So that every decision that will not bring good for me, God will deal with it. The Christ in me will somehow or the other make sure it does not come to pass, because it's Christ living in me. Praise the name of the Lord. Let's bow our heads again and pray and say, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, please come and take over my life, my home, my thoughts, my will, my desires, more than before. I surrender to you afresh. The children you have given me, my ministry, Father, I surrender to you, my marriage, my spouse, my destiny. Things I was convinced were of you, but may not be of you. I don't even know, but you know, but I hand them over to you, Lord. My heart, my will, my flesh, take them over, Lord. And I want more of you. Hand over everything that pertains to you. Hand them over to the Lord Jesus. Let's stand even this evening and say, Lord, take over even this world. We know you can do it. We're nothing before you can see. But we say, Lord, as we cry, take over. Let your glory fill the whole world, Lord. In the hospitals that the sick will rise, let your glory fill us. Fill me. Father, let your glory fill the whole world. Let your glory fill the whole earth. Fill my home. Fill my life. Fill my emotions. Fill my family, Lord. Let your glory fill the seat of government all over the nations, Lord. Let your glory even fill where the evil shrines are right now. Where your glory is, there's no sickness. There's no COVID-19. There's no sorrow. Everything is still filled with your glory, with peace, with joy, as was in the beginning in the Garden of Eden. Father, let your glory, Lord, be released by your mercy. Let your mercy bring an end, O Lord, to this affliction, which you have said is for a short time, O Lord. Father, I seek your glory. I want your glory in your church. Release your glory, Lord, that will be just like Jesus. We'll be just like you. From glory to glory, because of your glory, our tastes will be different. Our goals will be different. Our homes, marriages will be different, Lord. Father, please let your glory come down. Like you have said in Habakkuk 2:14, for as the earth shall be filled, for the earth shall be filled the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. Just as the waters cover the sea, Father, let your glory fill the nations, Lord. Let your glory fill my life with your children, whoever I come in touch with. When they see, let them see glory. They have the fear of the Lord. Lord, be wherever I am, O Lord, that without even speaking a word, people will see your glory in me, O Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, release your glory. We want more of you, O Lord. In Jesus' name we have prayed. And this evening, if you want the glory of the Lord, surrender your life to Jesus. Tell him and say, Lord Jesus, I want your glory. Where your glory is, there is no sorrow, there's no pain, there's no disease. It's like heaven on earth. Without your glory, it is hell. What is happening is like hell. So therefore, I give my life to you. Totally. Everything that's not pleasing to you, Father, take it away from me. Save me. Lord Jesus, save me. I give my life to you. Write my name in the book of life. Don't let me go to hell. Please take me out from the road to hellfire. Give me the grace to serve you and to love you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You are my Savior. You are my Lord from now. And help me not to go back into what you hate. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Praise the Lord. I'd like to pray with us now, wherever you may be. We pray in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for the word that has spoken to us. We pray, Lord, as we listen to it again and again, your word will minister to us. Even where we have not received your ministration and the word you have for us personally. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that your mercy will take over the nations, starting from each one of us, our homes and our families, and wherever our children, our loved ones will be, all over the world, in the villages, in cities, towns, where we're far from, but where you are present. We pray, Lord, your glory be a shield round about them. Will protect each one of us. Father, we pray your glory, O Lord, will take over every seat of authority that had been in leadership, that had been cut away from you. Father, let your mercy and your glory fill your church. I pray for everyone now, Lord, that because of this prayer, no evil shall befall any one of us. No plague shall come near our dwellings. In the name of Jesus. Father, we pray for fortification by the power of the Holy Spirit, the Christ in us. Lipro kashkapa kaskantarima lida Mazushka pokoskanta rima lenderemo. Ye pakushka pokaskanta rima lidereke sentara. If you are listening, put your hands on your head right now. Riposhka papakila kuskantara by draw your right hand on your head and your left hand on your chest. Karibo koshka pokaskanta rima lige diri mokoshkantara by draw. Mayikuskata limo santara by draw. Ipakoshka pokoskanta lima and every storm, every boisterous wind, every tempest, every raging storm. Ireboshka pokoskanta, wherever they're hiding, where are they being formed right now? Repokoshka pokoskanta rima lid, every evil news. Malikushka pokoskanta lima lidaraka sendara badru. Meyeboshkata lima koskenta. Thank you, Father. Father, we give you praise. Lord Jesus, declare your lordship. Father, thank you for your mercy. Be a shield round about us. Hide us in your glory. Hide us in your secret place, your pavilion, where you alone, you reign, you rule. Where the enemy and sickness and affliction and fear can never have access, in the name of Jesus. Father, everything in our roots, in our foundation, that is raising a storm right now. Father, we pray, Lord, destroy with the blood of Jesus. And let the fruit, the evidence of it, die. Wither in the name of Jesus. Let there be peace. Let the storm cease, O Lord. Let every contrary voice be stilled now. Blessed be your name, Lord. We pray for our Father and the Lord, Pastor Adebo, Mommy Joe. Let your glory fill them, their homes, their children, grandchildren. Let your glory take over all things concerning them. Let it be well with them. Blessed be your name, O Lord. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, we declare every sickness, every infection, every reinfection, everything that happened before, that wants to happen again, not of you, not of Christ, not of Christ, that's not of Jesus. Every stranger, spirit, soul, physically, emotionally, financially, in every sphere of life, we declare in the name of Jesus, die. In the name of Jesus, release the blood of Christ against you. We declare in the name of Jesus in every life, every home, all over the nations, we declare you are a stranger. COVID-19, effects of it thereafter, of medications that may have negative effects later that we don't even know. We declare concern every after effect of this COVID, every negative contrary effect be destroyed with the blood of Jesus in the name of Jesus. In every home, every life, every body, precious souls, we declare there will be no sorrow. There will be no sudden death. There will be no lingering death or sickness and affliction. Where people are afflicted already, we release the fire of the Holy Ghost right now to destroy to the roots such affliction. In the name of Jesus, those on the brink of suicide, those on the brink of giving up because of depression, we command you rise up. Arise in the name of Jesus. We declare it is not permanent. We declare it is temporary. Every spirit that's not of God, it is temporary for a short time. And we say in the name of Jesus, you will not go under. None of us will go under. Therefore, arise right now. Wherever you're on the sick bed, arise in the name of Jesus. Are on the brink of taking that wrong decision to terminate your life, to step into the wrong area, we declare that road is blocked in the name of Jesus. You shall live, shall not die. The glory of the Lord is upon you. You shall fulfill your destiny in the name of Jesus Christ. With long life, God shall satisfy you in the name of Jesus. The number of days you shall fulfill in the name of Jesus. Glory and honor is your inheritance, not shame and reproach, in the name of Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High, Jesus, who has shed his blood for a time like this. Blessed be your name, Lord Jesus. Jesus, you are Lord. You shall reign forever and ever. We give you all the worship and honor in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen and amen and amen and amen and amen. Amen. Hallelujah. It's time to take our offering. Please package your offering or your tithe
and your tithe and lift it up and pray over it by faith and ask God that you steal everything contrary in your life financially. That every negative thing in your finances that's bringing a storm will be stilled now in the name of Jesus. They'll be turned around. And we pray with you in the name of Jesus that the fire of the Holy Ghost will come down right now and consume that offering and be acceptable to the Lord, so that it shall bring increase in the kingdom of Christ in Jesus' mighty name. The account detail is displayed, as you'll see. God bless you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.